the same with salvation. When you really are born again and you know in your heart who Jesus is, He's your Lord and Savior, you just can't even fathom anything else but Him. You're not going to renounce Jesus as Lord and Savior. You're not going to turn around and just totally turn your back on Him. You're not going to do that. Amen? That doesn't mean you won't have seasons and times where you're tested, times where you feel discouraged. You won't battle with depression once in a while. You might even be like David and say, God, where are you? Hello? But that doesn't mean you doubt your salvation. That doesn't mean you turn your back on God. It just means you're in a season and a time of struggle, and the Lord's going to lift you out of it. Amen? Preaching is like that. You want to know, I am called. Bless God, I'm called. And it doesn't matter what they do to me, what they call me. Persecution's a big thing in the world today. Preachers, hey, you know, there's always a possibility of persecution. More people are persecuted every year now than in all the people persecuted during the whole season of the first century church. And it was horrifying. We just live in a utopia here in America. We don't understand and comprehend what Christians are experiencing and going through on the other side of the world. We think it is fantasy, but it's not. We live in a horrifying time because the devil is evil and the time is short. Amen. But glory to God, our commitment is firm in Him. If persecution to the degree in other places comes to America, if you're called to preach, you'll be like some of those in the 11th chapter of Hebrews. Man, you'll just rejoice. You'll shout but while they're sawing your head off. Amen. Somebody had a video was it this school or the other school last month? We're going around showing it. And they were showing a video where the Muslims literally had Christians with their hands tied. Some of you have seen this. The hands tied behind them. And they have a saw. Not a sword. Not an axe. A saw. And they're sawing Christians' heads off like that. Horrifying, but yet current news. So, when you're called to preach, you're going to preach, amen. Glory to God, I pray to God I wouldn't have to encounter that horrifying type of persecution. But I've made up my mind, if I do, I'm going to say, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Amen. I'm not going to heaven with the question pending, you know. Hey, I'm going to be faithful to the call, and you want to be too. So you want to make sure your calling is sure. Make sure that you're called by God, not by people or situations. The Jews marveled at Jesus because the Scripture says He spoke as one having authority. The word authority is exousia there. It means the privilege or the right. It says not as the clergy, not as the Pharisees, not as the Sadducees. You know what the difference was? They heard Jesus speak, and when He spoke, it was powerful. It was life-changing. It was like, man, this guy teaches and preaches, and he's totally radically different than when the religious people preach and teach. Wow! It's like he's bold. He has the right. He has the authority. What we're saying, there was an anointing on him that wasn't on those other people. Jesus' anointing wasn't because of style. It wasn't because of the techniques and the skills He developed in how to prepare a sermon or a teaching. Although those things do help us, and that's why we're talking about them, it was because He knew He was called to be a messenger. Amen. So we're going to take another break right here. I'll get to it. Thank you. Oh, yeah. I've been wanting to get that book.
That's the one you recommended.
Yeah.
Morning.
Hey, Pastor.
Hey, you doing all right, bro?
Yeah, man. Yeah, I'm going to get this book, too. Yeah.
You said you recommended it.
Yeah. Yeah, I want to own it, though. I've read it, but I want to own it.
What is preparing?
You got a good book. Hayden Robinson, he's probably the ugliest man on earth.
Yeah.
But I'm going to tell you, he is a phenomenal trainer when it comes to preaching and teaching and leadership and things like that.
Yeah. I read a few pages of it online.
Yeah.
The third edition, if you happen to go look for it, he said it's better because of the test, but the materials, the preparation materials that he gave, you know, to practice with.
Amen.
Nate's going to give you the...
He gave it to me.
Did he? Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
That's perfect. Good. I'm going to see if I can figure out a way to... I have to talk to my guy that's helping me with this.
Right.
No, we got this cross for our logo, but somehow...
Yeah, the dot cross.
Yeah, somehow blend it in, your logo with the cross.
Or just...
I don't know how,
but... What you can do is just, like, put it in the corner.
Yeah.
Somewhere down the bottom.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, that...
Subsidized, like... The
yeah, old, that,
like
that's, so, that's what I want, just to...
Once I get I'm working on the budget now. Oh, my God.
Oh, don't worry about that.
No, then we'll sit down and talk about Brazil.
Yeah,
that,
okay.
You know what I mean?
And yeah.
Because I want to, if we're going to do it, then how do we, what we need to do? Like, I just kind of need like a game plan to tell
sure.
the guy, we're going to, me and you're going to go over there first.
Yeah.
We're going to talk to this guy, and we're going to start needing $1,000 every time we fly.
Yeah.
You know, that kind of deal.
Yeah,
you know, or
sure.
Who we pay, that kind of deal. So,
yeah. Okay. Yeah, I've still got.
Because what I'm going to do is really cut everybody except their monthly, and I'll let them, like David Thompson, and come preach. That'll buy their air tickets.
Yeah.
I won't really be out. They'll give me half.
Right.
I can raise half of all that they need. Then the church can do the other. And the projects, got a few projects. The ones we're sending, we got four teams going this year.
That's awesome.
And then what I can do is just basically just say, this is the big one. Because really, I put 3 years of Cuban stuff, you know.
Yeah.
So outside of something, a storm.
Yeah.
Something going crazy, and then during Easter we'll raise. Last year we raised the $6,000 for. We have the sex trafficking house.
Yes. Yes. I remember that last year.
Okay. So we did. If we can do that, that takes care of all that. It's no money.
Yeah.
Now. You know what I mean?
Yes.
I always tell them we do them monthly.
Right.
But the deal is, I said we're going to do Easter. We're going to try to raise one.
Yeah.
But if we get two, then you're going to get all that we get.
Right.
But that kind of takes care of itself. So really, I can almost get it set up where I can just kind of maintain the monthly and then say, this is what we're going to be like. Have faithfully push
out. That's great.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Yeah, yeah. It'd be more of a faith kind of deal. Uh-huh. Say it's $12,000 a year or whatever. So.
Yeah, I just want to make sure you don't feel like you're somehow obligated. Because,
no, I want to do it. I want to be on the ground part. Listen, it's been 5 years that mission that has been going project kind of and I try to stop it but when I dumped those 21 when I was doing it the whole AG way kind of it was 21 and we were really on the high end, but we dumped them to Jim Hester when he was with High Point and he said I'll take them because he kind of knew most of them because he got me hooked
that's
up
great
with them. You know what I mean? I just told him, look, we're going to play a whole year and what we owe them this year.
Yes.
We'll give them a whole year. When we get to the end of the year,
and that's awful. That's very
year.
Generous.
So that's what we did. We gave them the whole year. So they had a whole year to find us again somewhere else. But I said, we're just not attached to them. You know, I got their flags. He was getting older, really couldn't kind of tell us what was going on.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's just one of those things. I didn't feel good about it no more because I haven't been there.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
I said, we're supporting them, but now I don't even know who they are. So what I did, said, for now on, I've got to go where we go.
Yeah.
I'm going to put my feet on it.
That's right.
Preach at it, look at it,
yeah.
Come back and say, we need 3,000 here. That's all we need, and then we're out.
Yeah.
When I went to Indonesia, it was a one-time shot. I just, went over there. When I sat in that room, listened to all them guys from Australia, I said, I can't touch nothing they're doing.
Right.
I'm a pimple to what they've already done.
Yeah.
They were only 8 hours from there.
Yeah.
We're 16 hours.
Yeah.
So I said, I just looked at Danny James, who's from Africa for us. I said, unless you tell me there's a project here, I'm this is not for me.
Right.
It's not that I'm scared of the Muslims. We went to Medan. We went to all that hideous place. But I said, I'm just telling you, you got to tell me. I trust you.
Yes.
If you get something working, I can kind of back you. But right now, I don't feel like dumping nothing here.
Yeah.
I'll go somewhere else.
Yeah.
I'll do something else. So that's the way I look at it. So we are project oriented. So if we can really get that rolling, and you got all the contacts, if we can fund it, you know, that'll be like the church. If we get together, money, we should be able to roll it.
Yeah.
Get it rolling.
What I'm going to ask you if this is okay.
Uh-huh.
What I want to do with my situation here, I think that right now, I don't know, we just started taking offering Thursday night.
Okay.
And we had $1,100 come in. Okay, so, but that's the first of the month.
In
other words, I'm trying to be practical and not get too, but I'm estimating somewhere between 3 and 4 right now a month that's going to come in. Then we haven't even opened as a church, so.
No. Are these people you used to know or all newbies?
They're like people that I know, but they don't all know each other.
Right.
They're getting, this is part of what I'm doing, is
you're
I'm building a bonding.
Right now, right?
I'm building my staff and everything.
That's what I'll do next time.
Yeah, and, so what I've done is I just told them Thursday night that I'm going to give each, I want to sow into their life, each one of their lives. I'm going to give them $250 a month.
Wow.
That's not much.
Sort of like what I do to all the other pastors.
Yeah,
like
and
$400 is it.
Yeah,
depends and what they do more. Like praise is a little more than
right.
Paul does more, but like Mark is not that much.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's $300 where theirs is $400.
Exactly. So, yeah. So that's what I told him I would do. And I said, I'm doing that by faith, obviously. And I said, and just to honor them.
Yeah, yeah.
And then, of course, right now we don't have a building or anything like right. that. But as it stands right now, that'll be, well, $3,200 if I pay myself $500.
Right.
Then that's $3,200, that includes me. So that leaves us with, I'm hoping, $1,000. And what I wanted to do with that was, if you know, you had talked about tithing. How do you feel if I don't quite reach 10%?
No, I don't do 10%. What I did is just whatever you took up. That's why I'm holding Mark to Mark, whatever you take an offering. To say, Mark has to because it's more sound like you don't have to do it.
Yeah.
But what he does is basically because he can bring 30 people and they raise about $200. And
yeah.
Because he's not going to raise a mission team. Ours
yeah.
is his.
Right.
So he's already got it. He's
yeah.
already can say, I got three churches in
yeah.
Cuba. I'm doing a work in
ours. Right.
That's what he's doing.
Yeah.
Where ours is be different. You need to just stockpile yours up where we can do the whole Brazil thing.
Well, I want to give to. Right. to I want
well,
to give to you.
Whatever you want to, just do it whenever you feel like what's laid on.
Well, because I am a missionary, I know what it's like to need to be able to depend on something.
Right.
And I know percentage, you can't really calculate what's going to come in, but you get a base idea.
Yeah, yeah. Just
so
tell, yeah.
I was wondering if it'd be okay if we gave you, our church gave you 5%.
Yeah, or 3 or whatever. Don't stretch yourself. Go low and then you can build.
Okay.
Don't hold yourself at 1%. It don't matter.
Okay.
Because where it's going to go is go right back into the Brazil account. You know, I'm just going to stock it right in there.
Yeah. But we want to. Yeah. I mean, I want to. Laurie wants to. We want to bring it in here. We wanted to do the 10%, but we got to looking at it.
No,
especially now, yeah. it's going to be tough. Plus.
No, because all of my goal is when we get 3 or 4 or 5 churches, my goal was just to get the monthly deal.
Yeah.
You know, we're paying this person $200 a month.
Yes.
But then we meet all their needs. Like the pastor Keith, we've got to meet all of them.
Right.
But like I say, Dan James running $80,000 to $100,000 now.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
My $3,000 a month and doing all his stuff, that is nothing no more.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's
yeah.
Like, but I keep it faithful, sort of like it's almost his.
Yeah.
It's almost like his paycheck.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Exactly.
And it's just us sowing into something big. It got bigger than us.
Yeah.
All business.
Which is awesome.
He made the connections and they're
right.
dumping it and they're running it through us and we're running it straight.
Yeah.
Through. I don't divert it nowhere else. He gets
yeah.
it all. So
yeah.
he's just boom.
Yeah.
He's building anything he wants,
yeah.
doing what he wants.
Yeah.
You know, he's bigger than us, really.
Right.
You know?
So, yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, because I don't want. I just want everything open and clear.
Yeah.
Because
no,
I want.
Don't stress it or nothing. If you didn't got, don't got it. My deal is I'm still trying to get it saying be on the ground floor.
Yeah.
Saying if we can only do 5 and y'all are putting up 200, we're going to do what we can with 700.
Yeah.
If we can push 1,000, you can push 300 or
yeah.
200. It don't matter. We're going to try to do what you said, try to start a school or a church over. If we got to
yeah.
build the church first, then the school.
Yeah.
Let's see how much it's going to cost to build
right.
a church. We go over there and we tell our congregations that we're going to build a church. It's
mm-hmm.
going to house 500 people.
Uh-huh.
Then we're going to build a school on top of that.
Uh-huh.
You've got the contacts to keep it running.
Yeah.
That's where we can feed it then.
Yes.
It's only $1,000, $500 a month or whatever.
Right.
And then I can fly us anytime we need to.
Yeah.
I'll just flip that and we'll get over there.
Well, I'm,
you know
I'm
I mean?
It's an, on another issue. I don't know. I can't make any, you know, everything's by faith.
Yeah.
But we're looking for a plane now.
Really?
Yeah, you know, my son's a commercial pilot,
right.
Tim. And he needs a plane. He's already got hired by ExpressJet, which they contract. ExpressJet contacts United, American, Delta.
Right.
So he'll be flying for them in their planes. He'll just be working for ExpressJet. And he took ExpressJet because they actually pay more money than American. You know how those contract deals are.
Yeah.
So, but they've hired him. They said as soon as you get your 1,000 hours in, you start the next day. Well, he's at about 300 right now. So he figured it, and we calculated it's cheaper for us to buy a plane for him than it is to have to pay rent on a plane.
But then you got the maintenance and fuel.
Right, but here's the thing. He figured all that.
Okay.
And we're going to come out about $4,000 cheaper in the end, and we can either keep the plane or sell it. Which to Laurie and I, we're kind of like.
You can rent it out too, right?
Yeah.
To
Laurie and I, we're like, hey, you know, we may hang on to it because.
Right.
So what I'm saying is that he will work 2 weeks on, 2 weeks off.
Okay.
And there can be a lot of times he can fly us places
right.
for just fuel.
Yeah. Oh,
you
wow.
know.
And just jump on in them 2 weeks.
Yes, and it's so nice. It's going to be so nice because we don't have to go through lines and,
Oh my God. It'd be nice. Yeah.
But he figured out he was going to fly. He didn't get, we were trying to get it before Christmas, and I haven't worked out the financing and everything yet, but he was going to fly me to El Salvador, and he figured it would take 6 hours for us to get there. Well, it takes 8 hours on commercial flight to get to El Salvador. It's actually faster in a private plane because of the route you take and everything. And it was only going to cost like $200 fuel. Fuel. It is cheap, but you know we're talking about a private plane, propeller plane, not jet fuel.
Yeah, double, you know, double prop, four seater.
Yeah, jet fuel. It's like one fill up's like $40,000.
Oh yeah, I was gonna say.
You know. Ready?
I'm gonna go get the food right quick, so I don't have
okay.
to rush so much.
What? Day's moving along, isn't it? I need to move along. Okay, we're gonna go ahead and start back. I'm having a good time with you guys today. Do you feel that I'm overdoing some of this?
No.
Okay, because at the rate we're going, it's going to be next time too. Yeah, exactly. The reason I asked the question is because I do have a tendency sometimes to be a little too repetitious. And you just have to go. Go on! If I start doing that. But I like teaching like this. This is the way I get to teach at CF&I because I have 30 hours to teach one of these lessons at CF&I. And I love it because I'm able to just really teach it and I don't have to spend as much time reading, you know, just to cover everything. So you let me know how I can best serve you, okay? If I get to overdoing a point, just somebody just go. Like that, okay? And feel free to ask questions if you have a question at some point. Okay, we were just talking about the scripture where they spoke of Jesus. I believe that's Matthew 7:29, if I'm correct. It said that Jesus spoke as one having authority and not as the scribes. And we were talking about how that the word there is exousia. It means the right or the privilege. It also implies a limited influence. In other words, he had influence in their lives. Now, we're talking about people who Jesus didn't have, perhaps, always the opportunity to build a relationship with. So there's a secret disclosed here, and that is that anointing and exousia power gives you influence on the spot. When you're anointed, when you're truly called of God, when you're preaching a message from the Lord, God will give you a limited amount of influence with the people you're speaking to. In other words, you got a message for them, God's going to somehow let them know that they're to listen to you. You see, and that's what Jesus had. In Luke 4:18-19, it actually says, or Jesus was actually reading these words from Isaiah. It says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He's anointed me to publish good tidings to the poor. He sent me to proclaim deliverance to captives and recovering of sight to blind men, and to send crushed ones away free, to proclaim an acceptable year of the Lord." I always try to remind myself, I'm called to preach the good news, that I have to be careful I don't start teaching and preaching like I raised my children. They were faithful to tell me that sometimes I got a little heavy on one side of the balance. But congregations often won't tell you that. They just endure it. But my kids would say to me, "Dad, everything with you is about principles." Okay? And I would go like, "Yeah." You know, if you live according to the Word of God, if you live according to ethics and integrity, you will have a blessed life. That's what the Bible teaches. And they're like, "But Dad," in other words, I was supposed to understand that there might be times when, you know, things are not as clear as how they were to me. You know how kids are. Well, I began to realize, listening to my children and also in preaching, that you can preach principles, you can preach moral living, you can preach all the things that you want to protect people from and that you want people to value in their lives, and make it good news. That even with my kids, it didn't have to always be, you know, the downside of things. And I found that was one of the mistakes I made with my older children. You know, our kids were spread out. Our last son seems to be so much more well-adjusted and solid, and I credit that to him, but I also have to say that it's because I made tons of mistakes with the first kids. As a pastor, as a father of pastor's kids, a lot of it was just I didn't understand how to be a parent. A lot of it was a lot of religious concepts and things that I was brought up under that I have over the years grown out of and freed my children from. Only for the older children, it was a little late. They were grown. But anyway, it is about principles, but it has a lot to do with how we present them. God gives us a message. Let me put it this way. It's like someone who has a prophetic ministry, whether it's the gift of prophecy or at the office of the prophet. We know that we can say things where people have a hard time accepting it, even though it is thus saith the Lord. Or we can say things in a way that people can just easily take it in and receive it and apply it to their lives. It could be the very same message from God, but it could be two different people in how they, through their personalities, and how they, through their presentation, deliver it. Okay? So I realize that preaching is the same way. We can preach and people cannot like what we say. That doesn't mean it's not true. That doesn't mean it's not a word from God. It means that's how we presented it. We can preach the very same message from God and people can love and just consume it into their lives, but it was the same message. And it has everything to do with us, with our presentation, our delivery. And so sometimes it's like a new person who is operating the gift of prophecy. New people operating in the gift of prophecy have to be open to a pastor or an elder's instruction and guidance to help them be better for the kingdom. That doesn't mean they don't have a real gift. It doesn't mean what they said Sunday morning, public, it wasn't good. They just need some guidance and instruction. Are you with me? This is true about preaching. We've all experienced this. It's sad, but it is a fact. The first thing people encounter when they come in contact with a church or a preacher is things of the flesh. You know, the first thing before you open your mouth, they see your hairstyle. Hello? They see your clothes, you know, which mine weren't ironed, by the way, but I put a sweater over to cover it. It's still not good. But my wife didn't want to get up early this morning. She's tired. She's doing extra duty, you know. Anyway, but you get what I'm saying. I wish it wasn't that way. But it is important what people see. We have a beautiful church here. That means something to people. They come in and they say, excellence here. They go, okay, things are, the natural tells me things here are right in the spirit. That's what they see. We have to understand that, you know. That's why it's imperative to do things right. That's why having a beautiful sanctuary is important, you know. God receives your praises whether you're in the field or in a beautiful sanctuary. But when we come in as a people, the environment here is conducive to worship. Even the stuff like the lights and the smoke and the large band and all the music and the different things, all those things contribute to our ability to enter into the presence of the Lord. Do y'all understand what I'm saying? I wish it wasn't about that, but God did give us ears and eyes. Amen? He gave us noses. That's why it's important to clean the bathroom once in a while at church. Right? So these are important things. The Spirit of the Lord can be upon you, and God will use you mightily. But if you're willing to learn and develop yourself, even in the natural, it greatly enhances your delivery and your ability to make an impact on people. Paul based his authority to preach upon a personal divine call to which the success of his life was largely due. For the same Spirit that called him also accompanied him, and it worked through him. And it will be the case with you. God will back up what you say when you say what he told you to say. Amen. Amen. So the non-commissioned preacher not only brings upon himself the scorn of men, but subjects himself to the judgment of despised and rejected God. Now, it's not that God gets mad at people who try to preach or to deliver the Word of God. Anybody can teach and be in ministry as a lay person. I don't like that term, but you understand what I mean when I use it. But God specifically likes to use people that he has chosen for the purpose of that. Because here's the thing with God. God doesn't just happenstance go, eeny, meeny, miny, mo, you preach and you too. He doesn't do that. God knows you in the womb. You are destined for a purpose in this earth. And so if you're called to preach, you've been called to preach. It's been in God's plan from before the foundation of the world. This is no last minute thought. You are not an afterthought of God. You're not an accident. Hello? God saw that you would be born at the season, the time, the year, the date, all those kind of things, to the geographical place that you are. All these things, God strategically ordered those for you to deliver His Word with the greatest impact in season and on time. So you're a big deal. Hello? You really are. You are a big deal to God in His ultimate plan for the kingdom. That's why being kingdom-minded is so essential. Putting the kingdom first. Sometimes it scares me to even talk about being kingdom-minded because people draw back so fast. And it is hard to do. But it is so important. You got to hear from God to know what being kingdom-minded is. I'm going to tell you what, it's hard to be kingdom-minded when God says, in faith, I want you to do this. When everything in the natural tells you, you need to do this first. That's when you really find out if you're kingdom-minded. You also find out how God is a supernatural God. Amen. So God will equip you to do what He wants you to do in the kingdom. So moving down here. So how do you know that you're called to preach? Well, you might be thinking that I know that I have the capacity to hear God because I'm a genuine believer, and I have the ability to hear Him because I'm close to Him and walking with Him. And if He were to call me to preaching ministry, I would surrender. But how do I know that I'm called to preach right now? Well, let me say it this way. I know because I have an inescapable conviction that the preaching ministry is what God wants me to do and it's what I'm supposed to do. You have to have that assurance. Okay? Somebody said, and it's been said many, many times, that you know you're called to preach when you try to do other things and you just about can't. I don't mean that you can't work a job or you can't hold down a career in some other capacity, but actually when every time, everything you do either doesn't work out or you end up coming back to the same thing over and over again. And I believe God lets people experience that so that they become confident of their calling. You know, I remember after we had pastored two churches, all of a sudden I got the bright idea that I was tired of dealing with these people. And I said, I'm going into what I know and what works for me. I'm going to open me a restaurant. So I opened a restaurant. Then I opened another restaurant. I had a two-chain restaurant company. And it was doing great. I mean, man, we were doing just great. And all of a sudden, I got to the point to where I was like, you know, this is fun. I'm excited. And we're enjoying this. I'm providing jobs for a lot of people and stuff. And it's a good thing. But there's still something missing. And I knew what it was because I'd already pastored two churches. And I knew what it was. I knew that it was the Lord dealing with me about preaching. Now, the whole time we were running the restaurants, we actually did children's church. So we didn't just backslide, you know what I'm saying? It was just a thing, but it was something God knew I needed to get out of me, okay? And I'm going to tell you what happened for me. I don't recommend it, but this is what happened. We were doing really good, and I began to get that divine frustration, you know what I'm talking about? Everything in your life's going right, and you're not happy. And you know that God's dealing with you. And I knew God was dealing with me about going back in the ministry. And I knew that there was no reason for it. I had a good income. I was happy. I was my own boss. I was doing restaurant work. I loved it. It was what I was good at. And it was like I was so frustrated. And Laurie always tells me, if you're not happy, I'm not happy. And I'm not happy. That's what she'll say to me sometimes. Because, you know, she knows how I am. And she cares about me being happy like I care about her being happy. Well, anyway, we had that conversation, and we wrestled around for several months, and finally, all of a sudden, this is how it happened. I don't recommend it, but it was a Saturday. Our restaurant in the next town was doing great. I had, you know, management in place, everything. I knew everything was good there, and the newer restaurant was actually in the town we lived in, and I was supposed to go in and open, and then the staff would come in about 11 o'clock, and we'd open for lunch at 11 o'clock. And it was pouring down rain. Now, Saturday's usually always your second best day of the week in the restaurant business. It's a slow day. In other words, people come in consistently all day long. You never have a big rush on Saturday, typically, but you have a good day, okay? Whereas Friday, you have a blowout you know, from about 6 until about 8. They just line up outside the door. But the rest of the day is, you know, kind of meager. But you'll have a great day on Friday. It'll be your best day usually. That's typical of the restaurant business. So it was Saturday. I was expecting a good day, but it was pouring down. And I thought, you know, we're not going to get as much business today. It's going to hurt our sales. And I'm just really wrestling over this thing. And finally, I'm standing, and I'm looking out at the street out the window of the restaurant. And I said, Laurie, come here. I had just flipped the sign, the switch on the sign, you know, to come on that we were open. She came around, and I said, it's raining cats and dogs. She said, yeah, it's probably going to hurt our sales today. I said, yeah. And I said, let's go home. She said, go home. She said, everything's set up. Food's ready. Everything's ready to go. She said, you want to take the day off? I said, no. I said, let's close and go home. She said, we can't close and go home. I said, we're going home. She said, are you serious? I said, yeah. I reached over, flipped the switch, the sign went off, and I said, let's go. We didn't even do anything but turn everything off. We had to come back later that day and put all the food up and everything else. I mean, it was like I had to get out of there. And she said, what are we doing? I sent all the employees home, everything. She said, what are we doing? I said, we are going back in the ministry. You know, and she said, okay. So we went home. We spent some time praying, you know, talked about it. I went and told my pastor, and he said, well, you sure this is the way to do it? I said, it's the only way for me. I said, I can't keep one foot in this and another foot in this. It won't work. Restaurant business is too demanding, too many hours. He said, okay. I don't recommend you doing that, but for me it was the thing that was needed to take place. We literally shut down 2 good restaurants on the spot and set our heart to follow God back in the ministry. Through a series of events, God even gave us a big miracle offering. I think I've told you the story in a little town in Wisconsin that paid off the little debt we had. We almost paid all our debt off, but we did have about $9,000 we owed at the bank. And God provided that in one offering. It was amazing. 40 people. But it was because that's the way God works with me. Do y'all understand? And it required me making that commitment to him and saying, I know what you want from me, and I'm not going to play games with you, God. It was almost like Elijah when he came by and threw his mantle on Elijah, and he said, come on. And Elijah says, wait, let me go. Wait, let me go. And he says, basically, Elijah said, forget it then. That's the way what I was feeling that the Lord was saying to me. It was, on the one hand, an exhilarating experience. On the other hand, it was a terrifying experience. But you know what? It was what God wanted for us, and we did, and it was powerful. And doors began to swing open, opportunities came, and we ended up back in the ministry just a short time right after that. Well, that's a tough thing, but you have to come to that conviction in that place of knowing what you're really called to do. Do you know what that did? That totally cured me of that old mindset of, if I can't make it in the ministry, I can make it in the restaurant business. You see, that was haunting me. That was tormenting me. And actually, from that time, I've been better as a pastor. I've been more effective. And, of course, the more I grow and the older I get, the better I hope to get. So it's an experience. How do you know you're called to preach? You just know it inside. I just knew that, yes, I can run a restaurant, and yes, I can make money. And I even got to have another restaurant later on. We had a restaurant that belonged to the church we pastored. In other words, I opened it. We used it to raise some money for a certain project to build on to our church. We raised the money, built the project, and we closed the restaurant. In other words, in my mind, I am not doing this. This is just to make money. I know how to make money. I, you know what I'm saying? I know that my people can't fund this project, but I know that I know a way we can fund this project. Y'all see what I'm saying? And I'm telling you, as soon as the treasurer said we got that money in the bank, it's there, we can do it, I said, sign off. We're out of here. And we did. So it's not that what I was doing was wrong. It was the place that it held in my life to give me assurance and security. Your security needs to be in who God says you are and not what you think that you can do or how you can provide. And for a man, that's a hard thing sometimes to get through because we want to be providers. We want to be good for what God's calling us to do. So there's an internal evidence that comes along with knowing that God is calling you and that gives you security. The internal evidence is based upon the motive that is common to all Christians. It's to serve God in the best manner possible. And added to that is the growing conviction that the ministry is the special method by which God designs him to work. So inside of you, you begin to know that you're called of God to be his messenger. It's a conviction that this is and this alone is the right thing to do. And that's what I came to that day as I stared out at the rain. I thought, you know what? There's nothing wrong with what I'm doing. It's working. I can't say I failed and so I had to go in the ministry to make a living. I had been in the ministry. I had pastored 2 churches. Now I'm back doing this and I know inside I can do this, but this is not what I'm supposed to do. That was my moment of crisis that I had to come to. So it's a conviction that this is the thing that we have. There's the external evidences that we will have. And these external evidences, they're really valuable to us. And mainly it's as a corroboration of internal convictions. And it's the will of God concerning us, and it may be made manifest through outward circumstances. First of all, there's the interference of God in the affairs of men. It often establishes their hidden but potential convictions. God may unexpectedly remove what seems to be insurmountable difficulties that prevented belief in the genuineness of the inner experience. See, I made the decision to quit that day. I walked out against most people's better judgment, okay? And again, I would say to you, I don't recommend that for you.